Good morning.
Good morning.
So first and foremost, I'd let you all know that today is Scout Sunday, so I'm sure some of you passed through some of the Scouts this morning. So to start off our worship service, and before we have any announcements, we'll observe the posting of our colors, followed by the Pledge of Allegiance.
I'll take the call.
Well, everyone, please join me in the pledge of the flag. Those not in scout uniform, scouts with, or those in scout uniform, scouts with, those not in their heart. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic which stands one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Please post the colors.
Thank you very much. You may be seated. It's great to have you all with us this morning, and thank you for joining us online, those who are able to. One announcement that I have immediately following worship, and so this is for Scouts too. So we're going to have our congregational meeting today. So as we finish, I know there's some refreshments and stuff like that in the fellowship hall, but we'll have a congregational meeting in the sanctuary real fast. So if you're a member, stick around, we'll do the congregational meeting, and then we'll head down for some fellowship. Any other announcements? I know we had some chicken barbecue stuff going on, right?
I still have tickets available if anyone needs them. But other than selling tickets, things are pretty much under control.
So if anybody wants some chicken barbecue tickets, we have some more left. So.
I have them right here.
Any other announcements? Let's take a moment of quiet as we prepare for worship. I invite you to stand as you are able as we respond to God's call to worship this morning. Our help is in the name of the Lord,
who made heaven and earth.
And in life and in death,
we belong to God.
Baptized into Christ's death,
we live unto him.
Come, let us worship God. Let us sing together hymn number 467.
Oh my God.
Friends, let us go to God in a common prayer of confession. So join me in our prayer of confession you can find printed in your bulletin. Eternal God, in every age you raised up men and women to live and die in faith. We confess that we are indifferent to your word. You call us to proclaim your name, but we are silent. You call us to do what is just, but we remain idle. You call us to live faithfully, but we are afraid. In your mercy, forgive us. Give us courage to follow in your way, that joined with those from ages past who have served you with faith, hope, and love, we may inherit the kingdom you promised, Jesus Christ. I invite you to a moment of silent personal confession. Friends, hear this good news. Who is in the position to condemn? Only Christ. The same Christ who died for us, rose for us, and reigns in power for us, and prays for us. Anyone who is in Christ is a new creation. The old life gone and the new life began. Thus be reminded we are forgiven, and be at peace. Amen.
Amen.
Christ be with you all.
So
more recent times we've been sharing the peace of Christ with each other just by greeting people around you or waving across the room. So I invite you to share that peace with each other this morning. Amen. You may be seated. Before we hear our scripture passages this morning, let us go to God in a prayer of illumination. Gracious and living God, we ask you pour your spirit upon us as we seek to hear and understand the words you have for us. Reveal to us within pages of scripture, within the message, within songs, within every moment of our lives. If there are words spoken today that are not yours, we ask you let them fall away and do no harm. We ask for all these things in the name of our Rock and our Redeemer, Jesus Christ. Amen. I have some help from the scouts this morning for our scripture reading.
Praise the Lord. Happy are those who fear the Lord, who greatly delight in his commandments. Their descendants will be mighty in the land. The generation of the upright will be blessed. Wealth and riches are in their houses, and their righteousness endures forever. They rise in the darkness as a light for the upright. They are gracious, merciful, and righteous. It is well with those who deal generously and lend who conduct their affairs with justice, for the righteous will never be moved. They will be remembered forever. They are not afraid of evil tidings. Their hearts are firm, secure in the Lord. Their hearts are steady. They will not be afraid. In the end, they will look in triumph on their foes. They have distributed freely. They have given to the poor. My righteousness endures forever. Their horn is exalted in honor. The wicked see it and are angry. They gnash their teeth and melt away. The desire of the wicked ones comes to nothing.
You are the salt of the earth. But if salt has lost its taste, how can its saltness be restored? It is no longer good for anything, but is thrown out and trampled underfoot. You are the light of the world. A city built on a hill cannot be hid. People do not light a lamp and put it under the bushel basket. Rather, they put it on the lampstand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others, so that you may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven. Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have come not to abolish, but to fulfill. For truly I tell you, until heaven and earth pass away, not one letter, not one stroke of a letter will pass from the law until all is accomplished. Therefore, whoever breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of heaven. But whoever does them and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven.
Thank you very much. So we heard from these two passages, one from the book of Psalm and the one from the book of Matthew. Both of them refer to life, but Matthew specifically talks about these equations of salt and light. But today's message, you may celebrate, right? It will be brief, right? We have a congregational meeting after to make room for that. I'm going to get right to the point in today's message and keep it short and sweet. But I don't want you to miss the point of this message, and that's for everybody today. You all are, to be the salt and light in this world. And what does that mean, right? There are two things that might go unnoticed unless you have studied biblical Greek or have taken time to stare at this stuff. Usually in Scripture, when it says you, it's actually plural, right? It's the plural you. Like I say in the South, that's where I'm from, that's the Greek version of saying y'all. Right? But in this case, it is saying you, singular, which doesn't happen all that often in Scripture, actually. Most of the message in Scripture are about us, together, you. Not one person, but this is a rare case. When Jesus is saying, you are, individual, the salt and light of the world. The second thing that might go unnoticed is this verb are, right? We translate it as are, but the verbs in Greek are rather complex, and different, all the words are, really. By their ending, it can mean so many different things. We translate it one way, but like one ending can be to, for, by, with, in, like, right? It can be all those things. It can change the meaning of what we hear. This case, it means it is not you should be, or you could be, or you will be. It is very specifically you are, currently active, right? You are this thing. You are salt and light. And he's telling his disciples that, and all of us that. You are the salt and light. If you don't know already, salt and light are essential to every part of our survival. It's not just about salt for taste or light to find your way, right? If you took light out of the equation of this world, how successful do you think things would be? We wouldn't survive, right? If you made salt no longer available, some of you aren't fond of the medical field or anything else, but as an EMT, and if you have nurses and doctors in here, and tell you, if you had no salt available in this world, again, you are not going to survive. But even at that, right, think of the more simple ways that we understand it. Salt and light for our church, our community, our world today. And how do we use it? How do we be that? Jesus put some equations out there and some stories, but I'll put it this way. If you fill a salt shaker full of salt and put it on your table and you never use it, what's the point of having the salt shaker there? You might be healthier, but that's a different discussion. If you put a lamp in a dark room, you plug it in, but you never turn it on, why did you put it there in the first place? That's what Jesus is telling his disciples. You are salt and you are the light. And if you don't do what you're designed to do and meant to do in this world, what's the point of you even being here? Salt, if added to food, so I love to cook, and you can probably tell I love to eat too. But when you cook and you use salt, it changes everything and it enlivens it. I remember one time I made some ice cream with a group of kids, right? So we can always set that up, by the way, if you want. Sounds strange, but we made, if you've ever had it, it actually is pretty good. Banana Oreo ice cream. The kids thought I was nuts when we mashed these bananas. I'm like, we need salt. They don't want the sugar or anything else. I'm like, no, you need salt. I want salt. And I dumped it in there, and I'm like, okay, taste it before. After I put the salt in there, let it set for a little bit. Now taste it. And they're like, the taste of the bananas is so much more powerful and enlightening, and there, because the salt brings it to life. It makes it where we can taste it and feel it and interact with it. Light is a form of energy, right? It's the base of almost everything around us, its existence. It removes darkness as well. It can reveal dangers, help us guide on our way. Jesus is described not just as light, but light for the world, for everybody. And we are part of that. If we're part of that light, he says, don't just put a bushel basket over top so that no one can see you using that light, and so your light does not get out in the world. But again, to each of you and everybody here, what does that mean? I'm going to boil it down very simply. Do what is right God's world and what God is willing you to do. That's it. To do what you know is right and live it out in the world. For the scouts that are with us this morning, right, there's a lot of words and mottos and everything you use to describe and values you hold in what you do as scouting. Base of it is those things help shape you into good members of society to contribute to the whole goodness of this world. And I'll boil it down even simpler. It helps you know what right to do in this world and how to live and be as a good human being. It helps you be the salt and light. I'm a member of a part of our denomination's work. I sit on the Advisory Committee for Social Witness Policy for our entire denomination. It's a group that we write policy that tries to inform the rest of the church what's right and wrong, right? To help guide them in what they're doing. It might not be that exciting, but we sit in a room and we write policy. But there's a journal that we put out every so often. And the title of that journal is Salt and Light. And it's that for a specific reason. Part of our job is to be a reminder to the church, because we get off track too, right? What it is we should be doing. What right and good things should we be doing in this world? So we don't lose our saltiness or lose sight and place some bushel over the light we are supposed to be shining in this world. In the end, it's actually pretty simple. To be the salt and light in God's world, we need to be doing God's will. To do what is right. Not just for yourself, but for all of humanity. For every human being you encounter. To be a witness to who God is, full of love, grace, and mercy and kindness to everyone you meet. Show it with the work of your hands, and the words of your mouth. So let us always be that salt and light in every moment of our lives. Amen. So friends, as our affirmation of faith, we will actually be using a scout litany. I've used it for, how long have I been ordained now? 8 years or something? So I've been using this for about 8 years. And it's taken from what I just said, those words that describe who a scout is supposed to be. And so I invite everybody to join with me in this scout litany. So I invite you to stand as you're able, as we affirm all of our faiths using this litany. A true and worthy person recognizes their obligations and does them without being watched or compelled.
The scout is trustworthy.
We owe much to many, to home, school, community, nation, and God.
The scout is loyal.
The Good Samaritan showed the spirit of doing a good turn.
The scout is helpful.
Courtesy is the mark of all faiths. It is shown in thoughtful acts and kindly respect for others.
The scout is courteous.
Kindliness is the way people show respect for others. Life is filled with things that we must do, whether we like them or not. One of the markings of growing up is our readiness to accept responsibility willingly. Our moods make our day. If we are grouchy, our day is gloomy. If we are happy, our day is always happier.
A scout is cheerful.
The world offers many gifts. A wise person uses them with care. To each of us comes danger, difficult tasks, and temptations. In the choice of courage or cowardice, may we be brave. Cleanliness is next to godliness. To have a clean body, a clean mind, and a clean record is a rewarding achievement. Character is determined by the things we worship. If we respect ourselves and our brothers and sisters, and we see them as gifts of God, of the goodness of God, we live on a high plane. Let us all say together, give us clean hands, clean words, and clean thoughts, O God. Teach us to work hard and play fair. Forgive us when we are unkind. Help us to help others.
Send us strength to do a good turn each day, and so live after forever. Amen.
Amen. I invite you to join with me as we sing hymn number 502. Are there any joys you'd like to share this morning? Gracious loving God, first and foremost, we come to you in prayer to say thank you, thank you, thank you. Thank you for everything we have been gifted. Thank you for this family of faith. Thank you for the Scout program that exists within our nation and this world. Thank you for those who give their time to lead, and thank you for those who give their time to take part in that program. And we give thanks for your healing touch in the world on people's lives who need it. We give thanks for healing of cancer and successful procedures. We give thanks for your doctors and nurses and caregivers who do your healing work. And we give thanks that we have a God in you that we can come to in our time of prayer. For those who have upcoming procedures, for those who have their own health challenges ahead of them, and for those who know the sting and reality of death in this world, we ask that you pour your Spirit upon them, sustain them and guide them in all that they do. Lord, we ask you to hear all of these prayers and those that were not shared. For in your name we pray. Amen. We now come to the time where we're able to give of ourselves for God's work in this world. That takes form in our tithes and offering, but as well as us discerning what it is God is calling us to do and be in this world, and to do and be those things. So as time of offering, let us do that as well as give of our gifts. Amen. To join with me in our prayer of dedication. Blessed are you, God of all creation. Through your goodness, we have these gifts to share. Accept and use our offerings for your glory and for the service of your kingdom. Blessed be God forever. Amen. So before I get into the more formal liturgy of what we'll do here, I shared with some of the scouts from the hallway, but I'll share with everyone. This is the table everybody is welcome at. So you, as we come around today and serve, everyone is welcome to take part as you are comfortable. And also, you can also feel free and comfortable to say, no thanks, right? Do not feel shame or guilt one way or the other as you join us in this occasion. One other note, if you haven't been here in a while, we do have bread and juice. They'll come to you separately. But we also offer these little pre-sealed things. So if you might still be a little hesitant with COVID, which is a reality for some, there's juice in the bottom and there's a little wafer in top. And so you'll just take that one whole piece and you can pull it apart and gain access to it. But we do have traditional elements. So if you don't want to mess with this, we'll have the other ones for you. Just so you know. Friends, this table is a joyful feast for the people of God. They came from east and west and north and south to set at this table the kingdom of God. Enemies sat next to people who used to be enemy and joined in this wonderful feast in the presence of our Lord. He took these simple elements, blessing them and breaking them and sharing them, reminding us that we are one, united together. May the Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
And lift them up to the Lord our God.
Let's give thanks to our Lord our God. It's right to give our thanks and praise. Let's go to God in prayer. We give praise and thank you, Lord, because you do wonderful things. In Jesus Christ, you make your salvation known for all people, completing the faithfulness you promised to the house of Israel, which you remember still through these gifts. As we share in this meal of simple bread and simple juice, we join the all earth in praising your name. And we ask you for your spirit upon all that we do here. As you feed us, make us instruments of your praise, servants of your faithfulness. We ask you to keep us faithful in Christ's service until he comes at last to establish justice and plenty on this earth. And we ask that you use us to bring that justice here and now, your kingdom into this world. And we ask that you hear us as we pray together as your Son taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Friends, on the night of his arrest, Jesus gathered with his disciples. After taking bread and blessing it, he broke it, saying, This is my body, broken for you. Take and eat, and do so in remembrance of me. And then, in the same way, he took a cup. And after blessing it, he poured it out for his disciples, his friends, and said, This cup is of a new covenant, shed of my blood for the forgiveness of your sins. Take and drink, and do so in remembrance of me. Friends, whenever you eat of this bread or drink of this cup, you are proclaiming the saving grace of our risen Lord, now and forever. Amen. So I do need some help today. I know, Lee, if you want to help me. If I have one other elder, actually. Last minute, I'm switching some things up, so we're going to see how we do. I'm going to do this for him. Just go ahead, buddy. So if you just want to take one side, I'm going to do it for him. So if you want to.
All at the same time.
Yeah. So if you want to go that way, I'll go this way. Thank you. body and blood of Christ broken for us all. Take and eat. Let us pray. O God, you have so greatly loved us, long sought us, and mercifully redeemed us. Give us grace that in everything we may yield ourselves, our wills, and our works as a continual thank offering to you, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Let us sing together hymn 536. Spirit, showing love and grace and mercy to everyone you meet. Amen.